Now we have with us Dr. S.C. Jain. He will be interacting with you on carbon trading and emerging new industry. I think we have been discussing regarding this cleaner production techniques and global warming, and in that context, this carbon trading is one of the hot topics, and I think this is the one topic where we almost all of us should know, okay, what is the carbon trading and how we can enter into this market, and by adopting cleaner production, so by adopting certain processes, we can save energy and basically save some of the gases, greenhouse gases going into the atmosphere and stop the global warming. Or we can say that we can have that sort of use that sort of a clean energy, and accordingly we can earn the carbon credits. Dr. S.C. Jain he was the former chairperson of chemical engineering department of the Punjab University. He has done his PhD in environment engineering also, and is a consultant to many industries particularly in the environment treatment technologies, and also he has many case studies on this carbon trading. He himself has contributed in few projects where this carbon credit concept has been used and has earned the carbon credits basically. So I think these case studies will be discussed during this session. So this is the one topic, and we will be having another session with him even tomorrow also. So I welcome you, sir, and thank you very much for accepting our invitation for interacting with the participants. We had about 15 or 16 centers connected to us.
Concept of carbon and credits.
There are about 4 to 5 centers in Rajasthan, 4 to 5 centers in Punjab, 2 centers in Himachal, and then few centers in Haryana and UP also. So apart from the participants from Haryana state, they are also attending the session in the studio also. So thank you very much, and once again welcome you for this session.
Good morning, friends. As I've been just introduced by Professor Sharma, my topic at present is carbon trading and emerging industry. You see, this topic I will take in 2 sessions. In one, I will introduce the concept, because this concept is something new to many of you and still in the process of being recognized globally. However, much of the foreign exchange has already been earned in last 1 decade. But still the topic is new as far as the classroom teachings are concerned, as far as the new industrial adaptability is concerned. So first lecture I will take on general concepts of carbon trading rather than giving you some case histories. And the next lecture I will give you the case histories we have done and earned exchange at the National Internship Board. Right here in the area of Haryana, Punjab and Himachal. The case studies I have chosen is from Punjab, Haryana and Himachal, especially so that you can see also those industries at later stage somewhere that how this trading has been done and how much the foreign exchange to the tunes of crores have been earned and put in the industry or in the government sector. Now, this carbon trading in fact is the new concept which is coming. Everybody is talking about the global warming. Everybody thinks that global warming is because of the burning, because at present what we need, the whole industry involves in the processing of finished products, raw materials to the finished products, and that needs energy and transportation. These are the 3 sectors primarily which dominates the activity of a society and economy of a country. Now, whether it is energy or transportation, both belongs to energy sector, and energy being taken from the classic fuels, fossil fuels, maybe coal, maybe oil, maybe gas, whatever that it is. Now, this burning of fossil fuel, in fact, becomes a major source of industrial greenhouse gases. Now, greenhouse gases, when we say, because primarily this coal, carbon content is there and it burns. Primarily, or majority of the, say, flue gases which comes out is carbon dioxide. But along with this, some activities are also there, the higher forms of carbon or fluorocarbons and so on. Many such things are there. And for our day-to-day activities, what we need? What we need is, say, starting, we need food. Then we need clothing. Then we need shelter, roof on the head, and finally the health sector. These four needs are the basic society needs, and all these needs come from the nature. And in that process, we say A conversion to B, and the finished product is our B. And in that process, some pollutions comes. And this, when we burn these fuels, a lot of emissions takes place. And this burning of fuels is for energy, and as is shown in this slide, it is power, cement, steel, fertilizer, any form for the processing what we need, we are burning basically the fossil fuels. And the gases which comes out primarily is carbon dioxide, but along with this, the higher potential warming potential gases like methane and fluorocarbons also emerge. And this concept of carbon credits that came into existence as a result of this increasing awareness, you can say, of the need of the controlling emissions. You see, earlier what we used to do, the flue gas comes, you have to treat. So air pollution control equipment, etc. are there. They are all investments are there. They are for running them also, you need the investments. And it is a major cost, you can say, at which puts on, and then the product which get becomes costly. So you have to cut that from that angle, from the industry point of view, otherwise also from the global warming point of view. So global warming issues have been given a serious thought in the recent time. Recent times means last 10 to 15 years, not earlier. So in the end, while it became essential to reduce these emission levels because of the global warming, what we say, an entirely new industry has emerged. What is an industry? Some raw material input, finished goods comes which have a higher economic value. So if we trap these carbons which are going into the atmosphere and sell them, or how to trade, I just explained, then it is also an earning potential. So it, I have given a name as an industry. It is also one of the major industries. It is not an industry in a geological sense. It is not an industry. The emblem being meritorious entity showing responsible behavior towards the environment. So it is our responsibility to protect the environment, and in that protection, instead of putting some money, we are now extracting the money out of that and try to save the environment too. So offsetting of these, say it is a way back, somewhere in 1968, and a Canadian scientist, John Daly, that has brought in the concept of tradeover. Say minor references are there throughout the literature as such, and the concept now is becoming a lucrative, say, venture at present. And important offshoots of these initiatives are only three, that is the carbon credits, carbon footprints, and green projects. Carbon credits you must have heard. Carbon footprints are also some of the civil engineers must be knowing. And green projects is a baby at present of most of the civil engineering aspects, while, say, having the concept. Now, what is this carbon credit? It has a generic term. Any tradable certificate or any permit which represents the right to emit 1 ton of carbon dioxide or mass of any other greenhouse with a carbon dioxide equivalent. Now, what does it mean? We burn carbon. Carbon dioxide is the extreme product. 1 ton of this emission has been taken as the basis for global warming. How many units you put in, more you put, more is the warming. But the other gases are also there because of the combustion. And those gases have a higher potential of warming than carbon dioxide. So we equate them. The warming potential of each gas we equate in terms of carbon dioxide. And that is what we mean by carbon dioxide equivalent. And that becomes some tons. So a numerical calculation comes, how many tons of carbon dioxide or carbon dioxide equivalent will come from burning of that, well, say 1 ton of fuel and so on. So that is this generic term. And in fact, it becomes then a financial instrument. Instrument that represents 1 ton of carbon dioxide or equivalent removed or reduced from the atmosphere. Because if 1 ton we put, global warming is there. So if we reduce this 1 ton in burning, or if we remove this 1 ton, it affects the lowering of the temperature and helps in, say, removal of carbon dioxide. So from atmosphere, from any emission reduction project. Now, emission reduction, normally we have, say, whenever there is a plant, there is a process, we say emissions are there, we have to reduce them. So that becomes what we attempt is called reduction process. It can be a reduction project, whatever that you can. Also, by the governments, by the industries or the private individuals, which say to affect the damaging carbon emissions that they are generating. There is a damaging effect when you burn carbon and put most of the carbon dioxide. Now, example of concept of carbon credit. Now, I take an example. I being a chemical engineer, I just started. First, I take a cement manufacturing. Now, in a cement manufacturing, that manufacturer reduces the carbon dioxide emissions by 1 ton by adopting some changes into the process, the burning process. It may be redesigning of the furnace or whatever, or insulations, whatever. In that process, it tries to reduce. Or by any other means, say by just, we may plant some trees in the factory so that carbon dioxide get absorbed. It should not go into the atmosphere, or whatever has gone, it should get absorbed around its plant, or then it is rewarded 1 carbon credit. If 1 ton of carbon dioxide he wants to emit, that manufacturer, either he reduces by adopting the technology, or he plants some trees around so that that gets absorbed there. So it is reducing the effect of carbon dioxide on that atmosphere. That is what is the concept of carbon credit. And through this example, I tried that why there is so much plantation around the industries around these days. It is only to catch up these, say, gases which have a warming potentials around it. The carbon dioxide can be sold to any industry, allowing it to emit 1 ton extra carbon dioxide, then it is allowable limit. Now, what is this limit? First, we should understand that. See, this global warming has been over the decades coming, and now it is alarming. So somewhere in the next slide, say the next lecture, I will tell the basis of allowable. But for the time being, you can say 1990 some base we had thought of, that up to that, whatever, say, temperature rise has taken place, whatever warming has taken place, let us restrict to it. We try to restrict it. It has not been restricted. We have tried to. So that becomes the allowable limit. So if I say to an industry, certain amount of ton he can emit, and if he is emitting more, then it means he has to pay extra for that warming which is putting into the atmosphere. And that is what we say is that carbon dioxide can be sold. Sold means if I am having, say, some value limit and I am below the limit, so I can sell my extra carbon credit which I have saved to an industry which is, say, selling more. Now, how are the carbon credits used? So carbon credit is now 1 ton of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. That is the unit. So it is a calculation in the equation, and we can find how much carbon dioxide we put in. So how it is used then, that credit? That credits are associated with either existing carbon dioxide or equivalent emissions from the atmosphere. In case of, you can say, carbon sequestration from, say, how it is squeezed, we may have forests, we may plant trees, or we start reduction of the future carbon dioxide from any renewable energy resources. Like, for example, solar energy may use, hydraulic energy may use, wind energy may use, and so on. And energy or efficient projects that displace fossil fuels for power generation productions. So alternative energy can be used. So they are all attempts for reducing that carbon dioxide aspect which is formed from the fossil fuel burning, which causes the global warming. So that is how it is used. Where do the carbon credits come from? Next question comes. I know carbon credit. I know how it is produced, but from where will they come? So they originate from the range of emission reductions activities associated with removal of existing emissions from atmosphere and reduction of future emissions. Both existing and future reductions, they cause what is the balance, and that is what is the carbon credit which you are gaining. So these are commonly called methodologies, say carbon reduction methodologies. You may have insulation, you may have a change of furnace designs, you may have alternating fuels, you may have a renewable energy, they are all methodologies. So afforestation or reforestation, they have been taken as a key means by which existing emissions can be removed from the atmosphere and carbon credits created, while construction of a windmill, for example, is another example which I have taken, rather than a coal-fired power station may create carbon dioxide. You may have a power station from coal burning, or you have a windmills, that is the alternative energy. So windmill saves certain amounts of carbon dioxide, which was supposed to be going to the atmosphere, which might have caused the global warming. So how much carbon dioxide which you need for same electricity to burn, and equivalent tons you calculate, and if that electricity being generated by this windmill, it means so many carbon dioxide you have saved. So that is what is the carbon credit, and that can be traded by the others who cannot have a windmill or who is having the power plant. Now, carbon credits, how you can make money from it? Carbon dioxide, the most important greenhouse gas produced by the combustion of fuels, has become a cause of global warming. That you know. Now, this devil is now turning into a product. This carbon dioxide, which is a nuisance for warming, somehow now the concept has come, it has become a product that helps the people, countries, consultants, traders, corporations, and even farmers earn billions of rupees. Examples, I'll give you local examples in the next lecture. So this was an unimaginable trading opportunity not more than even a decade ago. So it is a very recent phenomenon that how you earn that by changing the technology, by having the renewable energy, or by changing the fuels and so on. So carbon credits in trading now, they are part of the international emission trading points. It is a universal phenomenon. United Nations Environment Protection Agency recognizes it. They have given a unit to it. It is a tradable through a foreign exchange. So they incentivize companies or countries that emit less carbon. It means certain countries, because of the industrial growth, are putting more, and certain they are underdeveloped are not putting. So some incentive has to be given. So that is a trade between developing and underdeveloped countries too. In a developed industry and underdeveloped industry too. In a developed state and underdeveloped state also. So it is an exchange program, you can say. See, total annual emissions are capped, and market allocates a monetary value to any shortfall through it. I said market values, they go on changing on international trading. As in a foreign exchange, it is supply and demand. So that value gets changed. So it is a commodity like business in international market. Now, business can exchange. What does it mean? Buy or sell carbon dioxide credits in international markets at a prevailing market price, whatever that day. Today, whatever price is, it has to be traded like any stock exchange value. India and China are the biggest sellers, and Europe is going to be the biggest buyer of carbon credits. Steel industry in Europe is much more compared to India and China. So they pollute more. They are not allowed to pollute more. They are not allowed to pollute more. How it can be? So excess which they put Europe persons, we have in India saving that. So that excess they have to pay they have to pay for it from a global context to India and China. Or we can, if adopt the higher production, now our population is increasing, we have an industry more. So we are saving still some of this, and we can sell these credits to Europe, which is putting more carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. So last year, this global carbon trading was estimated to be 300 billion with India contribution at around 60 billion. This is statistics which I have taken from the Economics Times. Now, India is one of the countries that have credits for emitting less carbons. We don't have much industry yet. So there is not much of the emissions compared to the West, compared to Europe and compared to America. India and China have surplus credits to offer to the countries that have a deficit. How buying carbon credits can reduce emissions? Carbon credits create a market for reducing greenhouse emissions by giving a monetary value to the cost of polluting of air. Say we give some money consideration, how many euro one ton of carbon dioxide is, how many rupees per ton of carbon dioxide is. So we make the face value of that day. So emission becomes internal cost of doing business and are visible on the balance sheet alongside the raw materials and other liabilities. Now, when we have an industry, we put how much we import, what is the, say, utility services, electricity, raw materials, etc. Output is there. In that, we say how much carbon dioxide is also being generated, how many CRs. So it comes on a balance sheet. Cost of input, cost of utilities, etc. are the inputs. Then the product cost which is going. So in that, we say how many carbon dioxide we have saved. That cost is also coming. So it becomes a balance sheet. It is a part of the balance sheet at present in any activity. So I give you an example. By an example, consider a business that owns a factory putting out 10,000 tons of greenhouse gases in a year. It's just an example. So the factory is given a quota that only you can have, say, 80,000 tons per year. So 20,000, it means more they are having. So the factory either reduces its emission, it is forced to reduce the emission to 80,000 by some techniques, putting in some alternative techniques, technologies and so on, or is required to purchase the carbon credit to offset this excess from some other persons. They should arrange these 20,000. So one seller might be a company, now I am giving you the example, one seller might be a company that will offer to offset emissions through a project in the developing world. So some England company, they offer an assistance to offset our emission through a project, let us say in India. So such recovering methane from, let us say, agro product to feed a power station that previously, you can say, was using the fossil fuels. India is agro-based, agro fuels are there. So we can save. So they have to purchase. We can, this surplus which we are saving, 20,000, they can purchase. So although the factory continues to emit gases, that higher side I am talking, it would pay another group to reduce the equivalent of 20,000 tons of carbon dioxide emissions from the atmosphere in that year. So it is a trading between the two. What it means, a carbon trading. So another seller now. That was the first seller, it has the 80,000 limit, so 20,000 is purchased. So some another seller may have already invested in the new low emission machinery and have a surplus allowance as a result. He had already put in some extra machinery, some techniques, and he's saving. So the factory could make up its emissions by now buying these 20,000 of the allowances from them. So it is a trade. The cost of the seller's new machinery would be subsidized by these sales. So an UK company or an American company in India, the machinery is get subsidized by that money of carbon crediting which they are putting extra. So that is how this subsidies comes from the West to the Indian developing economy. Both buyers and sellers would submit accounts for the emissions to prove that allowances were met correctly. So it is a requirement by law that both will say that you have purchased and he has sold those 20,000. So it is a whole process of, you can say, buying the carbon credits. Important in the projects at present, I selected a few. At present, there are 316 projects in India. But top four are these: Delhi Metro Rail Corporation, Jindal Vijayanagar Steel, Odisha, Power Buddha Plant in Andhra Pradesh, and Handia Forest in Madhya Pradesh. Now we take one. Delhi Metro Rail Corporation. It has become the first rail project in the world to earn carbon credits because of using regenerative braking systems in its rollback. You see, these brakes, they work. For that, power is needed. But when the brakes are there, resistance is there, the power is also get generated. So they are trying to entrap that power. So they are saving that extra electricity which was to be used to have those brakes. Are you getting? So that saving of electricity itself is equivalent to some carbon dioxide which might have been put in for generating of that electricity. So this Delhi Metro Corporation, Rail Corporation, has earned carbon credits by using regenerative braking systems in its trains, and that reduces 30% electricity consumption. If the design of those brakes or recovery of the heat generated by those brakes into the electricity were not done, you would have put in 30% extra electricity, which might have been produced somewhere at the cost of global warming. So by generating this itself inside captive, they have reduced the electricity consumption in those rails. So they are entitled from the global trading community that they have tried to reduce the carbon dioxide to put in the atmosphere, and they earn some carbon credits, and it has been funded. The second is Jindal Vijayanagar Steels. Within 2 years, now it is almost ready. It has started earning, but within another 2 years, it will be ready to sell 1300 million worth of saved carbons. It is because of the furnace design in that carbon. So this has been made possible since the steel plant uses a Corex furnace technology, which prevents 15 million tons of carbon from being discharged into the atmosphere. It is a furnace design. You see, normally coal burns on some, say, you have a grate, you have a coal, you have air, you burn. Flames are there, like any agiti. Now, what they have done, that when you burn this coal, some black smoke comes. If you further burn that coke, it will be complete burning of that carbon. So this redesigning of that furnace is the technology of Corex technology. So it means complete burning. There is no smoke coming from them. Complete carbon has been burned to carbon dioxide because that produces heat, which is needed for steel productions. Otherwise, what would happen? In a normal furnace, that black smoke would have gone into the atmosphere unburned. It means more coal you would have used for melting that steel further. So reduction of that coal itself amount is there. When reduction of coal is there, means less production of carbon dioxide and burning is there. And that is what is being saved in this aspect of redesigning. So you can see 15 million tons of carbon saving is a much bigger saving. And this is India's second largest carbon capturing earning plant supposed to be. Third is your Power Buddha in Andhra Pradesh. It's a village in Andhra Pradesh is selling 147 tons equivalent of saved carbon dioxide credits. It has made claims of having saved 147 metric tons of carbon dioxide. Now, this was done by accepting biofuels. How? They have planted this pomegranate. It's a plant which, when extract, the oil comes. So they burn this oil. Carbon dioxide comes. That carbon dioxide itself is used for production of these plants. So that is what we mean by a biodiesel or a bioplant. Now I give you the example later how these biofuels are there. Fourth is the Handia forest in Madhya Pradesh. Same technology. In Madhya Pradesh, it is estimated that 95 very poor and rural villages would jointly earn at least 1.8 crore rupees per year from carbon payments by resorting 10,000 hectares of degraded community forest. Its formal inauguration is going to be on the 15th August 2014 and it will be left to the nation. Now it means they have, by plantation, they are entrapping the carbon dioxide. And when you entrap, you are helping the global warming. India being a forest, an agro-waste, so it has a much more potential. It is a better potential compared to the industry. We have from the industry too, but much more potential is also there in forestations. These are some of the examples I have taken from the international markets. Nike has sold emission reductions equaling 10,000 tons of the CO2. There is one company called Energy. Well known, somewhere TV you must have Energy. Energy is a company. This company has also purchased carbon from DuPont and Shell, is another company. They are purchasing, so they are international trading, say examples I am taking. Or this includes Expedia, Whole Foods, Heinz International and so on. The whole number of the Western countries are there. So this was about carbon capture introduction. I am not giving you the example at present as such as this. The another term which is prevalent in this field of carbon is what we say carbon footprints. Now a carbon footprint is again the total amount of greenhouse gases produced to directly and indirectly support human activities, usually expressed in equivalent of carbon dioxide, human activity. That was only for fossil fuels we were talking. Now it can be for any activity, maybe transportation, maybe petrol burning and so on. So a carbon footprint, you can say, print is an estimate of climate change impact of the activity, such as making a product, living a lifestyle, or running a company. Even to the day-to-day working, we are exchanging some carbon dioxide. I will give you a small example in this carbon footprints now. First, we have the explanation. What is this carbon footprint is? That was a classic definition I gave in the earlier slide. You see, when you are, let us say, drive a car, so the engine, you can say the fuel is burned in that engine. When you are driving a car, the fuel is burning. Now, which creates a certain amount of carbon dioxide, petrol, gasoline, diesels, whatever you have, so you burn. Depending upon the fuel consumption and driving distance, every car has a different fuel consumption. How many kilometers, how many miles, kilometers per liter and so on. So it depends on the fuel consumption and how much distance you have traveled. 100 kilometer, 200 kilometer, 1000 kilometer. So accordingly that carbon dioxide will come out. So when you burn oil, or you can say the gas or coal, so then also you generate carbon dioxide. Even if you, what you do, if you heat, let us say, a water in your geyser in your bathroom, or you heat your room by a room heater with electricity. You see, electricity being used, that electricity generation must have been done. Some carbon dioxide must have gone into the atmosphere too. So that's what I say, that the generation of electric power may also have emitted certain amount of carbon dioxide. Is it clear? So any electricity use must have been generated somewhere, and some carbon dioxide must have been there. Unless there is an alternative energy. I'm not talking of that. That is one of the methodologies to reduce carbon dioxide. Normally it will be used, so it will create a global warming. So even you have a geyser in your bathroom, or you have a heater in your room, or you are running your car, All these will have directly or indirectly contributed to global warming. When you buy, let us say, any food or food grains or any other product, the production of food and goods also emitted some equivalent amount. Let us say you have a coffee in a cup. The coffee production itself, it must have used certain energy somewhere. Some carbon dioxide must have gone. So it is in a global concept I am talking of warming of carbon dioxide. You may say that I am sipping a coffee, I am not producing any carbon dioxide. But production of coffee to and coming to your cup must have caught in the production some burning of fuel. Bringing you to your cup, some transport is needed which must have burned the fuel. So directly or indirectly, this sipping of a cup of coffee has also contributed some global warming, whatever scale it is. Cumulative effect, you can see how much it can be. So if that can has to be seen. So your carbon footprints is nothing but a sum of all emissions of carbon dioxide which were induced by your activities in a given time. So total emissions, coffee production, coffee making, coffee seeds, coffee grinding, coffee package, coffee to your table, all everywhere something energy has been used. So accumulation of that is what we say is a carbon footprint total. Now how to calculate carbon footprints? Now a carbon footprint is calculated by estimating not just the carbon dioxide emissions that the activity in question causes, of other greenhouse gases, and in some cases other types of climate impacts as well. So for example, an aeroplane is moving, some trail is there, so some heat is there, some gases are there, so they also be taken into account in the carbon footprint. For simplicity, you can say all these impacts are added together and expresses a single number of tons of carbon dioxide. Total, then you convert them to carbon dioxide tonnage. That is what the equivalent amount that would be create the same amount of say warming. Now, no footprints is so how to calculate? No footprint is precise. There are many existing and evolving standards for calculation of carbon footprints, but in truth, no footprint is precise. Methodology changes. Even for a simple activity such as you can say a burning of a liter of petrol in your scooter or in a car, which releases the known amount of carbon dioxide, you know 1 liter of petrol give how much carbon dioxide, you can calculate. There are still uncertainties about the emissions caused by extracting and refining this petrol. The petrol which has come in its making also some energy might have been used. So what about that carbon? So it is the addition of those. So how much footprint is, it depends. It is not one answer how much footprints can be there from one activity. Now, there are different approaches for estimating carbon footprints. The traditional way of estimating a carbon footprint, we say, is life cycle analysis. Life cycle, from birth to end and back. Now, this involves adding up as many as emissions pathways as feasible. As I said, petrol, you are burning, you are starting from there, but petrol has come from refinery. From refinery, from where it comes, from oil exploration and so on. So the total cycle, life cycle of that carbon from the oil well, why it has come from the degradation of the fossil fuels. So full life cycle has to be taken. So an alternative approach is to use called input-output analysis. How much is input, how much is output, that balance is to be taken. So there are many carbon calculators on the website. If you go on a Google and say carbon footprints, how to calculate, a list of websites will come from where different methodologies are available, and they help the people work out carbon footprints of their life and individual activities. I give you some simple examples. An example for calculation of carbon footprints from car emissions. Now, car emissions are calculated by dividing the kilometers driven by fuel efficiency of the vehicle. Every vehicle has a fuel efficiency. What is this coefficient? 1 liter of this gasoline or petrol burned, how much carbon dioxide comes? It is a simple chemical calculation. Carbon plus oxygen giving carbon dioxide. So how much carbon is given? So that is what we say is an emission coefficient. It is 1.96 kilogram of carbon dioxide released per liter of that petrol burned. And then it has to be divided by a factor. 1005.3, this we have calculated. This is so many kilograms per metric ton to obtain tons of carbon dioxide. So to make equivalent tons, it has to be divided by 1000.3. It is a conversion factor, you can say, of kilograms to tonnage in that. So this equation comes, you can calculate how many kilometers you have driven. Let us say from Chandigarh you are going to Delhi, it is 250 kilometers, okay, you have that. How much the fuel efficiency you put in that? Say 1 point, say whatever that 96 is there. So you multiply with that efficiency and simply divide by that conversion factor, you will get carbon dioxide. It's a simple conversion. So car driving from Chandigarh to Delhi will give you for your car, for a known efficiency, for the known amount of petrol used, how many tons of carbon dioxide you are emitting. Let us take another example. Example for calculation of carbon footprint from aeroplanes emissions. The total number of passenger revenue kilometers sold by any airline, Indian airline or jet or whatever you call, say any airline, the total kilometers sold by them and divided by total number of liters of fuel purchased by them. That is the index. In 1 year, how much fuel they have taken and how many kilometers they have flown. This one example I have taken from Indian Airlines, but any it can be. The total flight, how many kilometers, and total fuel used per annum. So both these numbers include domestic and international, because flights are less. Short flights use more fuel, long flights use less fuel, and so on. Now, the result of this calculation in fuel efficiency per passenger comes out to be 9.33 passenger kilometers per liter average. 1 liter of gasoline used, how many passenger kilometers, how many kilometers that airline has moved. And this is average over all flights. So short terms, say from Chandigarh to Delhi, or it can be from say Delhi to New York. Say over global, it is an average factor which has come. Now, because these aeroplanes, they are significantly more fuel, they consume more fuel during takeoff. When they fly, they use more. This number is an overestimation for short flights and an underestimation for long flights. Long flights, less consumption, short flights, more consumption. The average has to be taken. Now, this total number of kilometers flown, they are divided by this fuel efficiency per passenger, and it is multiplied by now for that aviation gasoline, the factor is 2.11 carbon dioxide per liter. A calculation. Now, this number is then multiplied by 2.7, what we say is a radiative forcing index. This is an instrument, this is an index used in global warming. Impact of the greenhouses other than carbon dioxide. This is standard given in all handbooks. This is a single number, 2.7. Now, aeroplane emit both what we say nitrous oxide and water vapors. You must say also some brownish streak is there when aeroplane moves in the sky. That is nitrous oxide and water vapor at temperatures high in this troposphere. Means from up to 16 kilometers. Higher, it will be changing. In the troposphere, it is. Both of which are now greenhouse gases. They create warming. So this index accounts for global warming potential. Now, of aeroplane emissions, which are due to this carbon dioxide. So again, the equation comes the same, similar. So this number in kilograms is divided by the same conversion factor, 1,005.3, and gives you the tons. So this standard equation comes. Now in this you can see whatever is your kilometers flown comes in the say aeroplane digit recordings, how many kilometers they had gone, passenger kilometer per liter, they are calculated, and simply you can have from this how many tons of carbon dioxide this flights, this airline has put in into the global warming. Regarding that is how you calculate, a simple example, the domestic example I will take in the next class. Now, these are some of the important terms used in reference to carbon footprints. First is the carbon calculator, then carbon neutrals, carbon offsets, carbon levels, and life cycle analysis. These are all terms. What is a calculator? It is just a tool. So, calculator is like this. It is a tool to help individual or organization track down carbon emissions. So, it is a recording and calculations, digitized. How much is carbon? So, it is a calculator determines primary carbon footprints through calculations. You can say based on the factors such as what is the fuel bill, how much is done, all digitized. So, it is like a hand calculator. So this online calculator can be used to estimate most of the annual direct and indirect gases emissions. These are available in the market. It is suitable for organizations and individuals with footprints, of course, less than 200 tons. It can't have bigger recordings. So it is a hand calculator type of things. Carbon neutrals or neutrality. It is a term used to describe action of organizations, business and individuals taking action to remove as such carbon dioxide from the atmosphere as each put into it. What is the goal? It is to achieve a zero carbon footprint. Our aim is it should be zero. It is never zero, but aim should be it is a zero input of carbon. So a business may plant trees in different places around the world to offset the electricity the business uses, carbon dioxide neutral in terms used to describe fuels. So some fuel burning is there, so they will plant trees, forestation, reforestation, etc. Those projects are being taken. So these are called carbon neutrals. I use the word fuels, biofuels, biodiesels. What are those? Just a glimpse of that. You see, biofuels, we sometimes say biodiesel is there, biomethanol is there, biobutanol is there. They are all carbon neutrals. Means they are attempt for zero carbon emissions. Since carbon dioxide release, when you have a fuel, it means it burns. Carbon dioxide will definitely come. But this carbon dioxide then is absorbed by the plants. So in other words, you can say carbon dioxide released by burning a liter of biodiesel today is absorbed from the atmosphere. Let us say I have a soybean plantation. So that being used to grow for tomorrow's liter of petrol. So that is what we say a biofuel. A plant is there, biomass, we burn, carbon dioxide is there. That is absorbed, we are planting those plants further, so they will absorb. Those plants will be ready for the next time. They will again be used for burning, carbon dioxide will come, that will be absorbed by another set of plants, and so on. So it, we try to have a zero impact of this carbon. So it is a net carbon, you can say, no net carbon is added. That is what we say. The another term is carbon offset. It is a process of reducing a ton of carbon dioxide emissions in another location for emission you cause in either your home, office, commute, travel, or any other activity there. Here I am producing and it's being consumed by that. So that is what we say is a carbon offsetting. My carbon which I put in, he's absorbing. Also at some other place by plantation is absorbing. That is carbon offset. So this offsets enables anyone to reduce their climate footprints by supporting projects, especially energy efficiency project may be there, renewable energy process may be there, or you can say sequential may be there, biomass may be there. They all reduce carbon dioxide emissions to offset one's own climate footprints. Why they are at it? With a cap and trade, these days we look for at a sale or a transfer or a trade of carbon offsets. They are needed because offsets allow countries or companies who are targeted to reduce their emissions. That is one aspect. Generally, achieve compliance at the lowest cost by using market forces to allocate capital. So main goal, of course, is to use the market forces to price an externality in the case of greenhouse gas reductions. Offsets can be generated from, these are the three techniques which we normally use. Energy efficiency, by reducing, let's say, amount of the fossil fuels, by heavy equipments or through addition of new technology, modification of equipment, etc. Or fuel switching, using a percentage of biofuels in that. These are coming these days. And education of operators, it leads to behavioral changes, thus reducing amount of. I give an example. See, small furnace is there. Some worker is putting coal in there. Suddenly, some smoke is coming. It puts small portions, less of the fuel, and more of the fuel coming into the air and so on. So that is the operational behavior. How will you produce carbon offsets? The cooperative members will produce offsets by installing technologies, or you can say mechanical interventions, working with operators. So information sessions you can give to the operators, how you can save, how you can help its efficiency. Some dialing you can do for fuel consumptions, some heaters you can use in the cars, earlier you used to have idle time, or a fuel meters you can use, controllers, thermostat controllers on fans, etc. These are all simple examples of reduction of carbon offsets. How will they be measured? Historically, baseline will be developed for each piece of machinery offset. Some baseline has to be made, and then a protocol to ensure that offsets meet. And technology will track fuel consumption electronically. And reduction in fuel consumption will be converted by a transparent, verifiable formula, as I mentioned earlier, for car and other people. They become a formula. Anyway, these days, if you go into the market, some green levels are there. What we say is the carbon levels. And you prefer to purchase that compared to the others, because they are the symbols of your concern to environment. So it describes the carbon dioxide emissions created as a byproduct of manufacturing, transporting, and disposing of a consumer product. So this information to consumers wishing to minimize ecological, you can say, footprints and contributions to the global warming made by their purchases. So your consciousness, it helps. So carbon dioxide or carbon leveling, you can say, is to provide information to the consumers or to the purchasers who are concerned about the impact of their choice on the global warming. Now, it is one instrument available to mitigate climate change that includes other trade measures such as carbon taxes or countervailing duties and so on. One is to tax the energies, this type of the leveling you give, and you become cautious about it. Now, importance of concept of carbon levels is that is for consumer groups. It is to have a concept of full promise and complexity. It gives you a complete detail that how much carbon saving has been done. That only carbon level you can fix. It is certified, certificate put in. So providing end user with the information about the carbon dioxide produced in the manufacturing, transportation, and disposal of products. It is a logical step in the worldwide. Some NGOs may be using, some business houses may be using, some governments may be using. They are all reducing the impact of carbon, you can say, on global warming. And over the past 5 years, recent past 5 years, these groups like NGOs, government, and businesses, each have played a role in developing and implementing carbon levels. If you go into the market, let us say go into the bazaar, you will find there better carbon levels. Then you try to purchase that product because you are concerned that in which the product formations, less of the carbon dioxide must have been put in into the atmosphere. So it is a psychological or your theological, I'll say, concept. Now, I use one word, life cycle assessment, and I said it is a standardized method. Standardized approach, you can say, to examine the entire thing. As you said, petrol you are using, from where petrol comes and so on, that becomes the complete life cycle assessment. Now, it is accomplished with the potential environmental impact of a particular product or process by compiling material and energy inputs and outputs. Total input, total output of energy. Evaluating the impact that these inputs and outputs will make and interpreting the results such that the consumers can make an informed decision about this. So these are the steps required. What is your goal? What is your scope? You have an inventory analysis, you have an impact analysis, and then life cycle interpretations is to be done. Goal and scope, of course, they define why life cycle assessment is being done. You should be clear why it is to be done and what method it should be used. And second, this information accuracy and interpretation needs enhancement of the decision making what are developed at this point. How will you do that? That is very important. Similarly, inventory analysis, it collects all the relevant data needed to complete this cycle. What are the inventories? What are the things needed for carrying out this LCA studies? So, in addition to the benefits coming from LCA, this inventories can help to compare products and determine policy recommendations. What route you should take for manufacturing of a particular product. Impact assessment, life cycle interpretations, these are the two terms widely used at present. Impact assessment step evaluates how human health and environment would be affected by the conditions identified in all these steps which I just mentioned. And life cycle interpretation is step researches reach conclusions and recommendations about the product and process. Ultimately, we should be in information used to make the decision based on the overall life cycle. Any one method you can use for LCA analysis. Now, these are the different stages for product development. Some materials may be used, some manufacturing has to be done, some packaging has to be done, some usage and some disposal. And all these carbon dioxide is to be, and this I have shown in this figure. You can see at each stage in this figure, some carbon dioxide is being the cumulative form of that will be the total carbon dioxide, and that will be the total carbon, convert them to say tons of carbon dioxide, and that is the carbon credit which you will be saving. So these are the general ways of LCA. One is end to end you are done, and another is you recycle it. Say if the assessment comes at the disposal end, it is called credit. These are terminologies used. And if the assessment begins from starting point again and it is set, then it is a cradle to cradle. This recycling, if you do, it is a cradle to cradle point. This is a typical example of LCA study in packaging industry. I just wanted to mention because it's much easier to understand what this LCA business is. The packaging is both a symbol of society's concern. A good package you would like to take. Packaging has a psychological impact of purchasing. So the user expects packaging to have a better strength. Even an envelope you take, you think that it should have a better strength. It should not tear it off. And easier in handling. Lighter it should be there. More aesthetic it should be from the point of view of hygiene. These are the requirements for any packaging materials. So manufacturing undertakes research and development to meet these demands and to offer high quality product. Packaging itself is an industry these days. Packaging material itself is an industry these days. So in addition to its standard attributions, today packaging must also complete, you can say, protecting the environment, environment friendly, and certainly must not damage it besides being friendly to human health. It should not be, it should be familiar to my handling, it should be environment free, it should be means hygienic in character, it should be environmentally friendly, it should have a strength. These are the requirements of a packaging. So this need of LCA study in packaging industry, so when there is a difference of opinion about the merits using these different types, some people say paper should be used, some say jute should be used, some say plastic should be used. All of this, we may say plastic monsters, but still there is a plastic packaging in large scale of the thermocol, and they are all plastic forms of the other. So in view of this, this in New Delhi, Indian Center for Plastics in Environment, this IIT based, which is located. So they have carried out a life cycle analysis for bulk packaging. Bulk packaging for jute, from paper, and from this polypropylene or high density polyethylene and so on, means plastics for making those bags. So the coverage of their study, I'm not giving that study, but what they had covered in this study is, this covers the environmental and reinforce the impact of this polyethylene woven stacks, in particular vis-a-vis jute and paper, from a stage of raw material extraction, production, uses and disposal, taking into account all input such as material, energy, capital, equipment, man hours, etc., and the outputs like products, waste materials and emissions at every stage using this cradle to grave means end results. The basis of the study has been considered as 1 million ton of bulk commodities in keeping with the view of consumption, you know, large amount of these packaging are used to see that bulk society daily has made this contribution. This is their paper now, as far as that study is concerned. This is their data which they have taken, and in this data you can see they have compared all these aspects of all the phases of the life. You need not wait. This slide will be with you. These are just their data which we have been taken as such. So what outcome was, I am not giving that detailed study. The outcome was that though plastic like this polypropylene or high density polyethylene are relatively new from us, the use of it in packing of bulk commodities adhere to the basic tenets of sustainable development more than in case of materials like jute and paper. And if it considers the consumption of energy emissions of the gases and the use of chemicals, so it is less in this plastic case compared to that of paper and jute. The analysis of the comparable life cycle with jute and paper clearly indicates plastics are economically affordable, socially acceptable, and environmental. Bulk plastics I'm talking, not the polythene bags. So hazards for workers in jute and paper are high compared to that in the plastic. That is their outcome analysis. So this is the total outcome which they have made. These are the phases involved in the life cycle analysis: production of raw materials, manufacture of sacks, usage, and the waste materials. This is the steps again. You need energy, you need water, and you need materials. So then we have the four phases, and finally it goes into the emissions. Last I take is that of a green project. Burning of fossil fuels are major source of carbon emissions in atmospheres we are seeing. Global warming impact is because of that. To check this menace, to some extent alternative energy sources have been used. One such alternative is the use of solar energy. I restrict to solar energy. It can be wind energy, it can be geothermal energy, it can be hydraulic energy, only, but solar energy is more common at present. So green projects in India, the Planning Commission of India will need to generate this 7 lakh, you can say, megawatt of additional power by 2030. This is their projections of the Planning Commission of India. India will certainly be looking towards alternative energy sources for the generation of, you can say, substantial portion of this energy. And solar energy production in India accounts for just 1.7% of the pie total in 2012. This is data of 2012 taken. 80 megawatt peak megawatts power consumed compared to the total world of 4700 megawatt peak. Several great green strides have been taken by the country to harness the potential of solar energy. The latest example of this figure, future forward thinking, is, you can say, Ravi Rashmi. This is the first project, housing project in India. This housing complex has been built on a plot of 1.76 acres at an extreme area. This is the location in Calcutta. 58 kilowatt project consists of 26 photovoltaic systems comprising 464 units of co-energy of the solar modules. The solar modules were customized to fit in that building roofs. Each home generates 2 kilowatt of power. The solar power generated is used to fulfill the electricity needs of the homes, and the surplus power is sent to the public grid. Some surplus is there. This is India's first building integrated photovoltaic project. The building integrated photovoltaic system would save 0.5 kilogram of carbon emission for every kilowatt hour of solar power produced. This is the complex which they have on the roof. This is the overview of that housing complex at the Calcutta. And the types of solar architects also depends, which have a passive as well as active. Passive makes the houses cool during the summer and shows natural light and better air circulations inside the house. Whereas active solar energy elements include solar water heating systems, and the housing complex has other sustainable features like garbage management systems, street lights, swimming pools, solar water heating systems, and so on. So friends, this type of system, even in Chandigarh now we are having. The UT administration has floated to the Ministry of Energy a project here that even in small houses like 10 Marla houses or 8 Marla houses, you can have this power generation plants. This is a subsidized unit, Government of India. The Chandigarh UT administration is giving a subsidy to the tune of about 40%. You have a panel of this type on the roof, and you can say, on an average, for example, at my place I have now water installed, 4 units per day is a minimum saving of electricity on an average in India. Because solar panels normally work about 6 months in India, effectively, others it will be annual. But this itself gives you, through an inverter, 4 units of saving. If you say 4 units of saving per day, in just in 3 years, your whole cost of this power plant comes. And in schools and other buildings, like university buildings now they are putting, and the excess which is there, that will be put in, will be purchased by the UT administration in the power grid. So this whole thing has come on a major scale from this Ravi asset, which is the Calcutta's first, India's first, you can say, the housing project. So in a nutshell, you can say now, because of the fast climate change, ecological changes, and global warming, due to a lot of emissions of carbon gases in the environment all over the world, there is a big concern that we have discussed. Since still we are depending more on burning of fuels, petroleum, biomass for meeting our day-to-day energy needs at the domestic level and industrial production level, and in transportation, emission of carbon dioxide has to be there, and so what we're using has to be there still. So only thing is that we have to set the limit of these emissions for an activity. And some industries emit more and some emit less, and the two industries can hook up, or what we say, they can trade excess carbon among themselves. So that is what I want to share with you. Any questions?
Many company might come get some credit, and after getting some credit, these carbon credit points, and does this add some cost to the product that consumer has?
No, no, it will be rather lowering. the product cost will get lower because the carbon, by carbon earning some extra money. So that money by law, I will be disturbing those laws in the next, he has to share that profit and that profit.
Rather than this cost will come down.
Yes. That is why I say carbon levels. They are generally, persons think they are costly, but in fact they are cheaper. Overall cost is less. So I don't think of how to react versus I need some reaction on this. It's on my audience.